absurd. You're a hero. And you look great.
Hello everyone, welcome to this video session. So this is second part, you may say second video of Wizard Concepts of Mathematics. So I have come with another exciting concept of the continuing chapter, that is quadratic equation. So it may take another video of this quadratic equation, and totally there will be three videos totally. So this is an excellent concept that I have again taken this time. Like, it's usually discussed, but many people forgot that because of the delivery of this concept to the students by teacher. It differs between a teacher and a teacher, but still people forget this because it's like we don't focus on that a lot. But when we come to solving a lot of quadratic, equations which are biquadratic as well as more than biquadratic, that I mean that degree of 5 or 6 or 7, we usually forget this concept and we get somewhat confused. Basically, we have no idea like what to be chosen, what not to be chosen. So that's a dilemma between these things. So I just wanted to clarify that concept today, and after this we still have another video of quadratic equations itself, where I teach the concept of reciprocal systems. After with that, we'll be keeping an end of quadratic equation. For quadratic equation, it's all done, the wizard concept. Okay, it's not like I'm teaching every concept of quadratic equation. No, I'm only teaching those concepts which are generally neglected by students as well as generally neglected by teachers, but it plays a vital role. Okay, it plays a vital role in solving many of the questions, either it may be in examination view or it may be in general solving view. In any of the view, these concepts play a vital role. I would say more than the original concepts, these concepts play a vital role in finishing them. Basically, in order to solve the problem completely, we need to have these concepts in our mind. So first, let us start this. So totally, I have taken three parts today, and the next video will be covering all the remaining wizard concepts that are left of quadratic equation. So let us start a video session. So it's basically properties of equations of higher degrees. I don't discuss a lot of properties. Okay, while coming to an equation like quadratic equation, we generally have the properties of sum of the roots as well as product of the roots. That's it. We don't have any other thing. So that's what only that's I'm gonna discuss in the other degree equations like 5, 6, 7, and you can suppose you can assume that to be n degree polynomial. Okay guys, so let me write that. So first of all, let's consider this polynomial. Okay, let's consider this polynomial a naught x power n plus a1 x power n minus 1 plus a2 x power n minus 2 plus so on an x power n minus 1 n minus n, it's nothing but an, okay, is equal to 0. Now this is a polynomial equation or of degree n. Okay, so for this equation, it has n roots. Okay, it has n roots. I have no idea whether these roots are real or imaginary. Okay, we have no idea regarding that. It can be some of the roots can be real or some of the roots can be imaginary. We have no idea about that. As well as there is another thing that we need to notice, a naught should not be equal to 0 because it's a polynomial of n degree equation. I don't it doesn't matter me if a1, a2, a3 and so on becomes 0, like equal to 0. But if a0 is equal to 0, then it's not a polynomial of n degree. So if I'm telling that this polynomial is of n degree, so definitely I need the coefficient of x power n to be there. Okay, it might be something, some integer, but it must be there. It cannot be 0. So coming to the properties. So property number 1 is basically nothing but, so property one is sum of roots. Okay, sum of all roots. Like if I take alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 as the roots of this equation, then alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus so on, because n roots are there, so alpha n is equal to alpha n is equal to, now how do you write this? Okay, how do you write the RHS, like right answer, like what is the basic formula for this is minus 1 whole power 1 a1 by a0. Okay, so what is the, I don't tell you the proof of this, I just tell you how to remember this thing. Okay, because this remembering thing is what people generally get confused. People don't take it seriously, or people don't understand the way teacher delivers it. So that's the reason. So it's very simple. Here I would say it's minus 1 whole power 1. Let me erase it. Yeah, it's minus 1 whole power 1. So alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, so on till alpha n. I'm not combining any of them, isn't it? I'm just taking only one thing, like only alpha 1. I'm just taking only alpha 2. I'm not combining like alpha 1 into alpha 2 or alpha 1 by alpha 2. I'm not combining them with any operation like multiplication or division. I'm just taking a single things and I'm adding them. So I'm not combining of any of them, or I'm not taking any three of them and combining them. I'm just adding them, isn't it? I'm just adding them. So it means that the sum of all roots taken all at a time, like it's like taken once, alpha 1 I'm taking once, alpha 2 I'm taking once, like that. So if I add them, so it's nothing but minus 1 whole power 1, because I'm taking individually, I'm not mixing up them, like an not multiplying them up or dividing them up. I'm just taking alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, so on, alpha n, and just adding them up. So individually I'm taking, so I need to put 1 here, because I'm just taking 1 at a time. Okay, and into a1 by a0. A1 is nothing but coefficient of x power n minus 1. Okay guys, that you need to remember, coefficient of x power n minus 1 is a1. In my case, in your case it can be anything, but you need to take the coefficient of x power n minus 1 divided by x power n. And here again, one resembles, you can remember in this way that I'm taking only one at a time. So second thing is, if I write alpha 1 alpha 2 plus alpha 2 alpha 3 plus so on, see here, let me write it clearly. Alpha 1 alpha 2 plus alpha 1 alpha 3 plus alpha 1 alpha n plus, now comes the time for alpha 2. Alpha 2 alpha 1 is already taken, alpha 2 alpha 3 plus so on, alpha 2 alpha n. In the same case, we have till alpha n minus 1 into alpha 1. So you may see here that I have taken alpha 1, like I'm combining two of them, isn't it? I'm just taking two roots from them, and I'm combining them using into or divide, like I'm combining them using a multiplication or division, isn't it? I'm taking two at once. So this means that here you keep minus 1 whole power 2 and minus 1 whole power 2 and take the coefficient of x power n minus 2. And now you need to take the coefficient of x power n minus 2. 2 in the sense, it resembles that I am taking two factors at once and combining them using multiplication or division, and I am adding them up. So it's minus 1 whole power 2 into coefficient of x power n minus 2, that's a2, divided by a0. A0 is always the coefficient of x power n. So you need to divide that by coefficient of x power n, is that you need to remember. So this is how you do it. So even I can take some more examples. So if I take alpha 1 alpha 2 alpha 3 plus alpha 2 alpha 1 alpha 3 alpha 4 plus alpha 1 alpha 4 alpha 5, see, like this, like taking all the three, you should not leave any type of combination left. Okay, you should not take any combination left. So alpha n minus 2 alpha n minus 1 alpha n, so this is nothing but minus 1 whole power 3 at once I'm taking, so cube into into the coefficient of x power n minus 3, that's nothing but a3 divided by a0. So if I see here, the coefficient of x power n minus 3 is nothing but a3, so that I'll be writing in the numerator and dividing by a0. So this is how you do it. So if I take the general thing, like you can take any things in this way. If I take the general thing like alpha 1, alpha 2, so on, alpha n, like I've taken everything at once, okay? I've taken everything and I've combined them. So there's nothing other left to be written. So it's generally multiplying every root, isn't it? I've taken all the factors and I've multiplied them. There's nothing left to be multiplied with another thing. So this is what the whole thing, or you may say it's like multiplying all the roots. It's basically nothing but minus 1 whole power. At once I've taken n and combined all of them. So minus 1 whole power n into coefficient of x power n minus n. Because all the n things I've taken at once, so x power n minus n, it's nothing but constant divided by, so constant it is a n, if you see here, if you go and see in the equation, it's a n. So a n divided by a naught. So this is the property for multiplying all the roots. So multiplying and adding, you, it's what you need to remember. So basically this is the thing. So how many number of things you're taking at once and combining them, that you need to put in minus 1 whole power n and the coefficient of x power n minus that thing. If I'm taking three things at once, like I've taken three things at once here, so I've taken the coefficient of x power n minus 3, that is a cube. So a3. So this is how you do this. Let me give you an example and get that clear. For example, if for n is equal to 3, we have some equation like ax cube plus bx square plus cx plus d is equal to 0. Okay, we have this equation. Now, if I ask you to write the formula for alpha plus beta plus gamma plus delta. Only three roots. I've taken the three roots to be alpha, beta, gamma. So alpha plus beta plus gamma is nothing but minus one whole power. I've just taken only once and adding them. That's it. I'm not combining any of them. So I'll just keep one here and into coefficient of x power. Here n is 3. So I'm taking only one. So it's basically x power 3 minus 1, which is x square. So coefficient of x square is what I needed. So b divided by coefficient of x power n, that is x power cube 3, which is nothing but a. So it's basically minus b by a. So come to the next formula, alpha beta plus beta gamma plus gamma alpha. So I'm taking two of them and combining them. So I need to put minus 1 whole square into coefficient of x power n minus 2, isn't it? What is n here? 3. So x power 3 minus 2, which is nothing but x power 1. So coefficient of x power 1 is c divided by a. So it's basically c by a. Now the third thing is alpha, beta, gamma. So what is alpha, beta, gamma? It's again minus 1 whole power 3 into coefficient of x power n minus n, isn't it? So here n is 3, so 3 minus 3, which is nothing but I need to search for a constant, isn't it? So what is constant here? D. So D divided by A. So it's minus D by A. So these are the formulas. So these are the properties that you need to remember. Basically, you just remember what I have told. You just need to put minus 1 whole power n, like how many times you're taking it and like how many of them you're taking and combining. Just you're taking singly, then you need to put one. If you're taking doubly and adding them, then you take two. If you are taking triple of them and multiplying them at once, you need to take three. And the later thing is, you need to search for the coefficient of x power n minus that thing. That's it. It's so easy. So coming to the next concept, reminder theorem. So this is a very important theorem. If you like, this plays a vital role in quadratic equations as well as any other equation. Like easy way of solving, if you search for any method for easy way of solving, the first thing that comes in your mind, it's reminder theorem. Okay, so reminder theorem almost settles you every type of problem if it's given, like in the question, if that's the way included, like in the n number of solutions for a problem, if reminder theorem is a solution for that problem, then I would guarantee say you that reminder theorem solution will be the easiest of everything. So always learning this concept will be a very important thing for you all people. So I will read the statement first. Let me take the black ink. Yeah, if a polynomial f of x, okay, if a polynomial f of x is divided by, so if a polynomial f of x, polynomial guys, if a polynomial is f of x is divided by a linear function, okay, a linear function is only what I am taking because it makes the thing easier. Basically that's the only reason. x minus lambda. So this is a linear function, like linear function can be x minus b, x minus c, anything. I have taken x minus lambda. Then the remainder, okay, then the remainder is f of lambda, isn't it? For example, if I take a quadratic equation like x square minus 2x plus 3, okay, is equal to 0. So the roots of this equation are x square, I need to take let me take x square minus 3x plus 2, okay, x square minus 3x plus 2, then x square minus 2x minus 1x plus 2 is equal to 0. So the roots comes out to be x is equal to x into x minus 2, x is equal to 2 and x is equal to 1. If I divide this polynomial, if I divide this like quadratic equation with x minus 2, the remainder would be f of 2. If I put 2 here, then it comes out to be 0. Yes, it comes out to be 0 because we already know that 2 divides this equation, isn't it? X minus 2 divides this equation. So if anything divides the other thing, so that definitely the remainder would be a 0, isn't it? So you can verify from this that if I put 2 in this equation, I'm getting f of 2 to be 0. That tells me that 2 x minus 2 divides this equation as well as the remainder comes out to be 0 if I put 2 here. So this is the theorem that if f of x is divided by a linear function x minus lambda, remainder is f of lambda. So let us give me an idea with the help of a question. Okay, for example, let me write the question. If the expression, okay, it's not an equation, it's an expression, 2x cube plus 3px square minus 4x plus p, okay, 2x cube plus 3px square minus 4x plus p has a remainder of 5, as a remainder of 5 when divided by x plus 2, okay, when divided by x plus 2, then they are asked to find a value of p. So this is the question. So 2x cube plus 3px square minus 4x plus p is remainder of 5 when divided by x plus 2. So what's the value of p? So as per the theorem, just substitute like x plus 2 is what is the dividend, like it is what dividing this one, sorry, it is the divisor. So x plus 2 is the divisor. So just put minus 2 in the equation. So 2 of minus 2 whole cube plus 3 of p into 4 minus 4 into minus 2 plus p is equal to 5, because this is what is given as remainder, isn't it? So just put on them, and so what you get here is 2 into minus 2 cube is minus 8, minus 8 into 2 minus 16 plus 12p plus 12p plus 8 plus p is equal to 5, isn't it? So minus 16 plus 8 is minus 8 plus 13p is equal to 5. So you get 13p is equal to 13, so p is 1. So this is how you apply the remainder theorem basically. So this is a very, very important concept. Like, we have very good questions on this remainder concept. This is just a basic question. I would teach all of these type of questions in JAN problems of mathematics. You can check that, because every problem that I'm going to discuss in JAN problem of mathematics will be helpful for JEE Advanced, as well as the concept that I'm explaining here will be helpful for you Olympiads as well as JEE Advanced too. So you can use the concepts here and the problems from there. I only discuss the basic problems here as well as the vital concepts that play an important role in every chapter. So coming to the next theorem. So next theorem is factor theorem. So this is also a very, very important theorem. So let me write the statement first. Basically, you can say that factor theorem is a special case, okay? It is a special case of remainder theorem. Okay? So, let's start the statement. So let me assume f of x, okay, let me assume f of x to be x minus lambda into q of x plus r of x. So r of x is nothing but remainder, q of x is nothing but quotient, x of my x minus lambda is nothing but divisor, and f of x is dividend. Okay, so this is nothing but, as per the remainder theorem, you know that remainder is nothing but if I divide by x minus lambda, so it's nothing but f of lambda, isn't it? As I have told in the previous theorem, if I divide by x minus lambda, the remainder is nothing but f of lambda. So I have written in this way, and this is nothing, there's no change in this, that's x minus lambda into q of x. Now if f of lambda is 0, okay guys, if f of lambda is equal to 0, then f of x is nothing but x minus lambda into q of x. So it's x minus lambda into q of x. That means that f of x actually is divided by x minus lambda. So this is what I've explained in the previous thing is too. That's the reason I've told you this is a special case of remainder theorem. So it's nothing but if f of lambda turns out to be 0. That means if a remainder turns out to be 0, then we can easily conclude that the thing that is dividing here will be exactly dividing that original dividend, isn't it? Because if f of lambda comes out to be 0, so x minus lambda exactly divides f of x. So this is the conclusion of factor theorem. Or you can even say that if lambda is the root of the equation f of x is equal to 0, then f of x is exactly divisible by x minus lambda. And conversely, if f of x is exactly divided by x minus lambda, then lambda is the root of the equation f of x is 0, and the remainder obtained is f of lambda, which will be 0. Okay guys, so it's basically, this is a special case of remainder theorem. There's nothing to be make a big case of it and then explain it. It's not a big thing, it's a very very easy thing. It's just a subset of remainder theorem, that's it. So if you know the application of remainder theorem, then it would be very very easy. So come to a question, I'll give you a good question now, like the basic ones itself, so you can just give a try. The question is if x square plus ax plus 1 is a factor, okay, if x square plus ax plus 1 is a factor of ax cube plus bx plus c, then find the conditions. Okay, so just find the condition. I'll explain you the solution. Now, since ax square plus bx plus c is divided by x square plus ax plus 1, I can write it in this way. Ax cube plus bx plus c is nothing but x square plus ax plus 1 into q of x. Okay, this is what you can write. Now, because this is a cubic function, isn't it? This is a cubic function and this is a quadratic function. So you just need a linear function in the quotient, isn't it? You just need a linear quotient, because this is x square and this is x is nothing but x cube, which is cubic. So that's the reason you just need a linear function here. So I can assume that q of x in the form ax plus b, some linear type of function, okay, some linear function. So just I'll just move to the next space. Yeah. So if I move to the next phase, I can write this as ax cube plus bx plus c is nothing but ax square plus ax plus 1 into ax plus b. Okay guys, this is what you can write. Now just equate the coefficients, okay? Just equate the coefficients. You write here, it's nothing but ax cube plus ax square plus ax plus bx square plus bax plus b, isn't it? Now just take every coefficient, ax cube plus, if you take x square to be common, you get a plus b, plus if you take x to be common, you get a plus ba plus the constant is b. Now you just equate the coefficients. So when you equate the coefficients, you get a is equal to a, equating the coefficient of x cube on both sides. Now equate the coefficient of x square, and we have 0x square. You can assume this to be in this way, 0x square. If I assume that, then I get a plus b equal to 0, isn't it? A plus b is equal to 0. And you equate the coefficient of x, you get you get b is equal to a plus ba. Isn't it? A plus ba. And when you equate the constants, you get b to be c. So you got practically four equations you got. So from this, you can conclude that. A is equal to a and b is equal to c. Okay guys, on solving this, you can conclude that a is equal to a and b is equal to c, as well as a square plus c equal to 0 and b is equal to ac plus a. These are the required conditions, that's it. So these are the required conditions for ax square plus x cube plus bx plus c to be exactly divided by x square plus ax plus 1. So these are the conditions. So this is how the questions basically get framed. So you just need to equate the coefficients. Basically, you need to use the factor theorem, that's like writing in that form, and then equating the coefficients, then finding out the necessary condition. That's it. So this is how you do it. And next question, there's a simple subjective type question. I'll just erase this. Subjective type question. A certain polynomial f of x, okay, a certain polynomial f of x, x belong to R, f of x, when divided by x minus a, x minus b, x minus c, leave remainder a, b, c respectively. This leaves remainder a, this remainder b, this leave remainder c respectively. Then find the remainders when f of x is divided by x minus a into x minus b into x minus c. So this is the question. Like when the f of x is divided by x minus a into x minus b into x minus c, a, b, c are distinct, you can consider in that way. Then you need to find the remainder. So by the remainder theorem, we have already studied the remainder theorem. Because it is divided by x minus a and leave a remainder of a, we can conclude that f of a is equal to a, isn't it guys? Because since we have studied the remainder theorem, that when it's divided by x minus lambda, we get f of lambda to be a remainder. So here f of a is a remainder, that is nothing but a. In the same ways, f of b is equal to b and f of c is equal to c, isn't it? Now you can write this as f of x is equal to x minus a into x minus b into x minus c into q of x, that is coefficient, plus some r of x that we have no idea. Okay, that is what we need to find, the remainder that it leaves when it's divided by this whole thing, x minus a into x minus b into x minus c. So just substitute now f of a. Okay, just substitute f of a, you get r of x, isn't it? Just substitute a here, a minus a is 0, so q of x into this also will become 0. You will be left with r of a plus 0, which is nothing but r of a is equal to a, isn't it? Because f of a is equal to a. In the same case, you can write it in this way, f of b is equal to r of b plus 0, which resembles that r of b is equal to b. In the same ways, c is equal to f of c is equal to r of c plus 0, so r of c is equal to c. So this is what we have got basically. So the equation, now come to the next phase, I'll explain it in a deeper way. So the equation, I can consider this equation r of x minus x is equal to 0, right? R of x is minus x 0 as three roots, a, b, c, because we have got this, right? When you keep r of a, you are getting r of a is equal to a, that's nothing, basically it's nothing but r of a minus a is equal to 0. So it's nothing but r of x minus x is equal to 0. So this is being satisfied by a as well as b as well as c, isn't it? But its degree is almost at most 2. And when you see the equation like of r of x, when you see the r of x here, you are seeing that we have x my f of x, a certain polynomial, isn't it? F of x to be a certain polynomial. and x minus a into x minus b into x minus c into coefficient, some degree of coefficient, we have no idea regarding that, and r of x. Now we from this we can conclude that r of x can have only at most, like what do you say, the maximum degree possible for that is 2, isn't it? So you need to see that r of x cannot exceed the degree of 2. From this you can say that, but if you come here, so if I can take r of x to be a quadratic, I can take r of x to be a quadratic, but here quadratic is being satisfied by a, b, c, three things. So a, b, c, it's being satisfied by three things. So that means that r of x minus x must be a zero polynomial. Okay guys, r of x minus x must be a zero polynomial. Or you may say it is an identity. Yeah, it's a spelling mistake. It must be an identity. Okay, it must be a zero polynomial or it must be an identity. Therefore, r of x is equal to x. So whatever thing you want to divide by, like if you divide with r of, if you divide it with d, then you get remainder to be d. If you divide it with e, you get remainder to be e. So it's basically an identity, or you may say it's a zero polynomial. So here you need to make sure that you need to identify the degree of r of x. Okay, its degree is at most 2, it cannot be more than 2, but here it's being satisfied by three things. So a comma b comma c, when it's being satisfied by more than the roots of the equation, then it becomes a zero polynomial or identity. So here identity is nothing but it will be satisfied by any number. So r of x is equal to x will be satisfied by anything. R of d is equal to d, r of e is equal to e. So remainder will be the thing that you want to substitute there. So this is an identity. So this is a very very classical example. I hope you all understood this. So this is the maximum thing that we will discuss in this session, Wizard Concepts of Mathematics video part. Like, it's the second video of quadratic equation. I hope you all enjoyed this. So in the next session we'll be learning the reciprocal systems as well as some important properties of the polynomials. Okay guys, the number of real roots or the number of positive and negative roots, that is also a very very wonderful concept and a very good concept. I hope you'll all see that too. So signing off, thank you for watching this, goodbye.